Eu gostaria de dizer que é um imenso prazer. It's our great pleasure to have you both, Kenneth Hima and Imer Flores, here today for some discussion. And we're going to divide our presentation in two parts. So in the first part, Professor Hima will present his paper in the way he will explain you about how he's going to proceed. He asked me whether we could make something more interactive. And about probably a quarter to 11, we're going to make a stop and a short break, and then we will convene with Professor Imer. Okay, so just a brief presentation. Professor Kenneth Inar Hima is professor of University of Washington Law School in Seattle. He's a visiting professor in many different law schools, including Belgrade in Serbia. He had a bachelor's from University of Illinois, Chicago, and a master from UCLA, and a JD from University of Washington and PhD from the Washington University. And he has been working on many issues of great interest for us, especially concerning dimensions, flaws, or maybe the powerful aspects of legal positivism. And he's one of the major, I would say, players in the current debate on legal positivism and its enemies, different kinds of enemies, so intellectual enemies, of course. So it's a great pleasure to have you here, Ken, and I hope you can enjoy your stay as much as people from Belo Horizonte, where he was coming from. And so without further ado, I give you the word. Thank you very much for being here with us.
First of all, I want to thank you for inviting me. It's an honor and pleasure to be here. Can everybody hear me? Okay. All right. So, I tend to be a positivist. I am a positivist, a hardcore positivist, a positivist from the beginning, a positivist to the end, I shall always be. However, the thesis that I'm going to describe is actually a thesis that Ronald Dworkin would accept, and few positivists, if any, to my knowledge, accept the thesis. And what I want to argue is that coercion is a conceptually necessary feature of law, and in particular, the thesis is that the authorization of coercive enforcement mechanisms is a conceptually necessary feature of law. Most legal positivists have rejected the idea that coercion is a necessary feature of law. Joseph Raz rejects it on the strength of an example we'll talk about, the Society of Angels. The Society of Angels would need law on this line, but not coercive mechanisms. So here's an example of a system of law without coercive mechanisms. HLA Hart rejected the idea that coercion was a necessary feature of law on the basis of the idea that international law is actually law. On my view, and this will be part of one of the bigger parts of the paper, it seems odd to me to reject a claim that is as potent and potentially explanatory of what reasons law gives to obey the law on the basis of, in Hart's case, half a paragraph, in Raz's case, three paragraphs. I think there's something methodologically odd about that. So what I want to claim then is it's a conceptually necessary feature of a legal system that it authorizes coercive enforcement mechanisms as a response to the violations of at least some laws. Now, here's what I'm not saying. First of all, coercive enforcement mechanisms, and this is a mistake, I think, that pervades thought on the issue, doesn't necessarily refer to punitive sanctions. Sometimes it does. Punishment is a punitive sanction. Sometimes it doesn't. The contempt sanction, a judge can enforce a court order by putting a non-complying party in jail in order not to punish, but in order to induce compliance. So this use of a coercive enforcement mechanism is not punitive in character. I think it's also important to understand that now John Austin characterized the sanction of nullity as a sanction. I think that's the wrong way to think about it. What I do want to say is that coercive enforcement mechanisms can give a reason to act, both when they're applied and when they're not applied. You know, if I put together a contract with somebody, I want to make sure that the whole purpose is to ensure that the other party's obligations are enforced. So to the extent that they're not enforced, that can hurt me and provide a prudential incentive for me to actually abide by the terms of the contract. So I just want to make clear that the availability of coercive enforcement mechanisms should not be thought of as being synonymous with what Austin called sanctions. And I think one of the reasons that positivists have declined to recognize the essential role of coercion in legal practice is because they confuse the notion of a coercive enforcement mechanism with the simpler notion of a punitive sanction. The other thing I'm not claiming that a legal system ever actually has to apply coercive enforcement mechanisms. Just a threat is enough. It might be enough to induce compliance. For example, an armed robber doesn't have to shoot you to get your money, and in fact, that's the wrong way to go about it. You know, a good armed robber simply makes the threat, and people comply. You know, if somebody puts holds a gun to your face and says, "Give me your money," and you don't comply, well, to be honest, you're kind of an idiot, because you're going to get shot. See, it's the threat that does the work. So there's nothing in my thesis that claims that a court ever has to apply coercive enforcement mechanisms, right? What I am claiming is that it is a necessary feature of law that they have to be authorized for at least some violation of laws. And that's a very mild claim. And let me give you a sense very quickly for how mild it is. And somebody should keep track of time, because I can go off forever. Les Green recently wrote a paper responding to Frederick Schauer's book, The Force of Law, which Schauer tries to do something interesting in the book. He tries to find a conceptual place for coercive enforcement mechanisms in the theory of law, but he doesn't want to claim that they're necessary. Les Green, in a review of Schauer's book, argues, look, here's the role. The most that you can say conceptually about coercive enforcement mechanisms is that every legal norm has to be capable of being enforced. But the only way to do that, right, and he takes himself to be opposed to the position that I'm going to take, that law is essentially coercive. But he's taking the same position, he just doesn't know it. The only way that it can be possible as a matter of law to enforce a norm is if coercive enforcement mechanisms are authorized. It's got nothing to do with the form of a norm. Any norm can be coercively enforced. That's a trivial claim. So if we read Green as making any sort of substantive claim, he's actually endorsing the view that I'm defending here. He just doesn't know it. Well, he knows it now, because I've suggested exactly that in an email to him. Okay, so we understand then exactly what it is I'm claiming and what it is I'm not. Now, the first thing I want to do here, and this is crucial, I need to say something about the methodology for doing legal theory. And intriguingly, the claims that I'm going to make methodologically about how to do conceptual analysis come from two people who would disagree with my conclusion. H.L.A. Hart, whom I said rejects the conclusion I argue for on the basis of the claim that international law is really law, and Joseph Raz, who rejects the claim I'm defending on the basis that a society of angels would have a need for some kind of mechanism to regulate disputes without having without a need for coercive enforcement mechanisms, and that would constitute law. I am going to argue that both of their views is inconsistent with their own methodological views on how to do conceptual analysis. That's going to be part of the argument. So how do we go about analyzing a concept? Well, Hart was probably the first person to say anything at all about conceptual methodology, and he didn't say much. What he said, and there wasn't any reason to say much because this is typically taken for granted in philosophy. Legal philosophy is a form of philosophy. Conceptual analysis goes on everywhere in philosophy. You worry about the concept, what is the nature of religion, what is the nature of mind, what is the nature of free will, what's the nature of morality? Most metaphysical questions in philosophy are really questions of conceptual analysis. So, and there's been a methodology that's been presupposed for a long time in some respects because of necessity. I mean, if you're going to make an argument, you have to start from somewhere. You can't give an argument for every claim that you're going to defend. Otherwise, you'll just argue infinitely. You'll try, the justification for any claim will involve an infinite regress. So you have to start from some foundational claims that are assumed because they're obvious. And that's the methodology that Hart described. Hart claimed that the concept, that conceptual analysis, analyzing the concept of law, should conform to ordinary intuitions, or what he said, what he called the understanding of a man on the, and I'm pretty sure I'm mispronouncing this because someone corrected me the last time I said this, Clapham bus, you know, some kind of bus in London. I don't know what it is, and I don't really care. So for Hart, methodologically, in order to do conceptual analysis, what we do is we start from ordinary intuitions, the ordinary understanding of the ordinary man. Now, there's something right about that, right? Because everybody has an understanding of law, and everybody's understanding of law contributes to what the content of the concept is. Why? Because our concepts are defined by linguistic practices, by our language. What we do with language is carve up the world in terms of a conceptual framework. So any concept that we have will be defined in part by linguistic practices, by the definitions and ordinary understandings about how to apply those definitions. So he's certainly right. And what he's gesturing in the direction of is a deeper methodological claim, and the deeper methodological claim is this, that concepts are social constructs. And there are people who disagree with that view, and I've written on this topic, but as far as I can tell, if you take the position that concepts aren't constructed socially and that they're mind independent, there's no, you have no plausible methodology for doing conceptual analysis. There's no epistemology for reliably determining whether a particular theory of a concept is correct. Okay, so Hart is partially right, but Raz goes a step further. On Hart's view, linguistic practices are going to be part of what you have to look at in order to analyze the theory of a concept. I mean, let me give you an example. I know that bachelors are unmarried, right? Not because I have some kind of independent intuition about the nature of bachelors, but because bachelor means unmarried adult male. So our ordinary intuitions that inform conceptual analysis are formed by and grounded in the meanings of words. And that's where we have to start. And that Hart got absolutely right. But Raz realized that there was more to it than that. On Raz's view, it's not just the linguistic practices that fix and determine the content of the law. It's, in some cases, it's other social practices. In the case of institutional concepts, it's the linguistic practices plus the institutional practices themselves. So when Raz articulated this view in an essay called Authority, Law, and Morality, and Raz pointed out that our concept of authority is what it is because of our social practices, our legal practices, and other practices regarding authority. So in the case of law, the concept of law is not only determined in part by ordinary understandings and linguistic practices, but also by core paradigm legal practices that can be empirically observed. That's the starting point. That's the starting point. Now, that has a really powerful, powerful implication. And sorry about making the P sound so right into the mic. Sorry about that. That implies an epistemological principle, a very strong one for evaluating the theory of a concept. Namely, and Raz is aware of this, and he states it explicitly, there are certain ways in which we can be mistaken about the content of a concept. But the way in which we can be mistaken is limited. We can't be systematically mistaken about the content of our concepts. Why? And to be systematically mistaken is to be completely mistaken. Mistaken in the sense that our mistake covers a broad range, so it has a horizontal dimension, a broad range of legal practices, but a vertical dimension, it goes all the way down. And the reason for that is this. Simple, works beautifully. If our social practices construct our concepts, then our social practices can't be systematically mistaken. So, any theory of a concept, an institutional concept like law, has to largely conform to the social practices that construct it. Okay. So, every now and then I want to just stop to make sure I'm being clear, because it's my job to be clear, and so far am I doing okay? Everybody is at least clear on what I'm saying. Good. All right, so let's take a look at what Hart has to say. Some very, very general claims about what Hart has to say about the concept of law that we're interested in. There are different uses of law. Laws of nature are descriptive claims about how the world works. The world is assumed to work in causally regular ways, and laws of nature describe the causally regular ways in which the world works. There's some descriptive claim about the rate of acceleration in a vacuum on Earth, right? If you drop something, it will accelerate at a certain rate. The velocity at which it accelerates towards the ground occurs at a certain rate. That's not the notion of law that we're interested in. We're interested in a normative notion of law. And there are different kinds of normative laws. There are moral laws and there are legal laws. So he wants to make clear exactly what normative notion of law we're interested in, and what he has to say is this. Hart identifies municipal law in a modern state, as picking out the sense of law that we're interested in as conceptual jurisprudence. As he puts the point, and he uses the term municipal law in a modern state on page 79 in the Concept of Law, the first revised edition. As he puts the point, the purpose of this inquiry, quote, is to advance legal theory by providing an improved analysis of the distinctive understanding of a municipal legal system that gives rise to the modern state. Now, right there, methodologically, that constrains the normative notion of law that we're looking at. So the notion of law that we're concerned with defines municipal legal systems in the modern state. And a modern state is defined by a legal system. So the notion of a state is conceptually related to the notion of a legal system. Okay, so here's one way of trying to identify the essential features of law. I mean, there'll be other questions that you have to ask, but one way to think of this is, well, what purposes do states characteristically serve? What are we trying to do with them? Now, I want to be clear about something. I'm not claiming that this is the conceptual function of a state. or that it's a conceptual function of a legal system or a conceptual function of law. But for beings like us, states characteristically serve certain purposes. What's the purposes? Purpose. Well, one way of getting a sense for what the purpose is to look to social contract theories of legitimacy. And I'm not endorsing social contracts of legitimacy, although I think they're the best game in town. I don't think anybody's produced one that succeeds, but I still think they're the best game in town because they ultimately locate the legitimacy of the state in consent, and that's a very popular idea and still has a grip on the views of most people. But the purpose of a state, according to a social contract theory, is to get us out of the state of nature. Now, I'm not necessarily claiming that, but there's the way in which the argument is made is very interesting. It tells us something important about why we need states. Why do we need states? Because we have certain psychological characteristics, and the world has certain material characteristics that are likely to give rise to conflicts, violent conflicts. So what are these characteristics? Human beings are self-interested, right? I mean, we come hardwired into the world self-interested. But here's the problem, right? We're self-interested beings. We're hardwired to be self-interested. If when you see an infant, all they care about is themselves. And according to psychological theory, an infant, the first major developmental step that an infant takes psychologically is to figure out that the infant is not identical with the world, that there are other things in the world than the child. And how does that get done? Well, you frustrate the child's needs. And all of a sudden, the child figures out, hey, I'm not alone in the world. And then altruistic interests, we're hardwired with the capacity for altruistic interests, but they have to be actualized through the process of socialization. So at first, all kids care about is themselves. And then, as they come to individuate themselves from the rest of the world, they come to care about other people until they reach puberty, and then all they give a damn about is themselves again. But so we are inherently self-interested beings with needs that have to be satisfied for us to survive in a world of material scarcity. There's not enough stuff to go around to satisfy all their needs. And that naturally leads to conflict. And given the nature of self-interested beings, I don't think I have to justify this claim, we frequently resolve conflicts by getting mad and resorting to violence. So in the state of nature, the problem is, forget the state of nature, an anarchic state. Most people are afraid of an anarchic state because the result would be a free-for-all. Imagine tomorrow that the Brazilian government said, hey, there are no restrictions on murder, there are no restrictions on violence, there are no restrictions on theft. Are you going to want to walk around the streets on that day? I'm not, because it's going to be a very bad day for Brazil and for a whole lot of people in Brazil. There'll be lots of murders. That's the kind of being that we are, and that's why we need law. So what this tells us is that the characteristic purpose of the state, if not the conceptual function of the state, is to keep the peace among self-interested beings who live in a world of material scarcity. That is the fundamental problem to which the state is a solution. So in thinking about the characteristics, the essential characteristics of law, we have to keep in mind what it is that a legal system is designed to do, and legal systems define states. So law is by nature a distinctively human institution, and I should warn you here, right? Right away you can see, once I've made this claim, what I'm going to have to say about Society of Angels arguments. Because Society of Angels ain't distinctively human. They have radically different psychological characteristics than us, and so you can already see the direction in which what I've already done, the direction in which this is going to go with respect to Society of Angels arguments. I'm going to say, this just got nothing to do with us, and law is a human institution. So, one response you can give to this is you can claim I'm begging the question, but you're going to have to disagree with the analysis that I just gave here in order to make that objection stick. If I've got you here, then I've got you with respect to the Society of Angels argument. Just to kind of be a little gangster about it. All right, so we understand now methodologically what we have to do. We have to give an analysis of the concept of law that conforms to the social practices that construct it. Now we've looked at the purpose of implementing these social practices, and we see they have something to do with the psychological characteristics we have and the characteristics of the world in which we live. We're self-interested beings who live in a world of material scarcity, who are prone to resolve conflicts of interest by resorting to violence. Now, how might law do this? Well, obviously coercion is one very, very effective way of doing it, but let's take a look at paradigmatic legal systems, right? I want to be very, very rigorous about following the methodology established by Hart and Raz, because I think that's the only coherent methodology there is. Thomas, of course, will disagree with this because he's a Dworkinian, but Thomas is not going to disagree with my conclusion because he's a Dworkinian. Dworkin takes the view that I'm arguing for. So I just want to, I'm sure Thomas is going to come at me very hard with a little question, what purports to be a little question intended to start the conversation, but is usually a kill shot. An attempted kill shot. So I just want to prepare everybody for this. So coercion in existing legal practice. It's ubiquitous. It's everywhere. We have never, ever seen any paradigmatic example of a legal system that didn't employ coercive enforcement mechanisms. You know, I said something about international law. That's a borderline case. That's a borderline case. People are still arguing about whether international law is really law. 50 years after Hart wrote on the issue. So one of the most conspicuous features there is in every existing legal system is that it employs or authorizes coercive enforcement mechanisms for the violations of at least some laws. So the coercive character of law, if we're looking at the legal systems that we know, is no less conspicuous, no less all-encompassing, no less ubiquitous than the fact that laws are norms, right? It's every bit as ubiquitous, it's every bit as conspicuous. Now, that's incontrovertible. No one can argue. No one can offer an objection to that claim. That's just an empirical claim that comes from our experience. And the very reason that international law, people are still arguing whether international law is really law, is because it's the first system of something that we've called law in the relevant normative sense of referring to a distinctively human institution that doesn't employ coercive enforcement mechanisms. But it's not just that coercion is ubiquitous. It's utterly central. It's utterly central. It lies at the heart of our legal practices in every legal system that we've ever had experience with. It is utterly paradigmatic as far as our empirical experience is concerned. And our empirical experience is relevant because it reflects, it observes the social practices that construct the content of the concept of law and form the test for evaluating conceptual theories of law. Now, so how is it central? Well, the very point of taking a dispute to court is to not only have the court decide who's owed what, or what the various parties' legal duties or legal obligations are, it's to make that decision and enforce it. There's no point in my going to court, if I'm having a legal dispute with you, if the court's just going to give an opinion and not enforce it. That's just a waste of my money, because lawyers cost money. And it's a waste of taxpayer money, because the institutions of justice are financed by public money. Although officials are frequently bought by private money. Corruption's a big problem. Indeed, right, the very notion, a language difference might figure into this. In English, the very notion of actionable, whether or not you can bring a dispute to court. The very notion of actionable is defined in terms of the possibility of coercive enforcement. Black's Law Dictionary defines actionable as, quote, that for which an action will lie, furnishing legal ground for an action. Okay, that gets you actionability. But then, right, the definition refers us to the related term cause of action, which is defined as, quote, a fact or state of facts to which law sought to be enforced applies, enforced against a person or thing applies. So the very notion, the very concept of an actionable dispute rests on the ability to enforce a decision deciding the merits of that dispute. Now, this is important. Why does coercion work? Why does that help us? How does that help us solve the problem of keeping the peace? Well, look, violence works. You know, if you and I are having a dispute, I mean, let's forget about the law for a second. If you and I are having a dispute, you know, you got something I want and you don't want to give it to me, if I beat you up, I'm going to get what I want, you know, absent any worries about the law. Violence works. If somebody points a gun at you and says, give me your money, you won't give the money unless you're insane. So violence works because it appeals to our self-interest. And recall, I observed earlier that human beings are inherently self-interested. Violence works. So that explains why coercion can help to solve the problem of the state. Why coercion can do the work we need the state to do in order to keep the peace among self-interested beings who live in a world of material scarcity. Because one way of deterring violence is by providing bigger violence. So the way it typically works is this. Look, you know, not a bad guy, but I've had a fight or two in my life. Physical, but I ain't gonna have a fight with somebody if there's a cop present. Because, you know, whatever it is I want over a fight, whatever it is I fought about in my life, is not worth jail. So coercion works, right? When you think about what law is a distinctively human institution and what the purposes of a legal system or the characteristic need for a legal system is, it makes to keep the peace among beings prone to violence, it makes perfect sense that the state itself will authorize violence, coercive enforcement mechanisms as a way of enforcing and dealing with bad behavior. So everything is fitting together now. So here's the upshot. This, on my view, establishes at least a prima facie case for thinking that the authorization of coercive enforcement mechanisms is a conceptually necessary feature of a legal system. And no one ignores the importance of coercion. You know, I think Fred Schauer's book, The Force of Law, is a very important achievement. But he abandoned an earlier view that was right, and a view that I'm essentially going to take. Schauer earlier argued in a paper called, I think, Was Austin Right After All? The Role of Sanctions in the Legal System. He said, look, you know, if you don't take the position that coercion is a necessary feature of law, then your concept of law is bizarre and detached. I think he either used disturbingly, dazzlingly, or some other disparaging adjective, detached from the reality of the situation. And on my view, he's exactly right. He's exactly right. But because, you know, so many influential theorists have rejected that, he sort of backed off, and now he was trying to do a number of really interesting things in The Force of Law, answer conceptual, normative, empirical questions, and kind of combine them in an interesting way that is not obviously entirely successful. Law rules that can be enforced by the state. And that actually seems right. at least as far as our empirical practice, our legal practice is concerned, that's exactly what law is. If somebody wants to ask me, or if my youngest niece, you know, who hasn't started to think about conceptual analysis, asks me, Ken, what's the difference between law and morality? Well, law are rules that are made by people enforced by the state. And morality, on my view, is, and most people's view implicitly, are mind independent. They're not manufactured by human beings. So Hart was just wrong with respect to his view that there aren't any settled principles with respect to the linguistic conventions governing the use of law that necessarily refer to coercive enforcement mechanisms. That's just false. But the real problem here is that he's assuming that international law is not only a non-degenerative case of law, right? Non-degenerative, by this I mean it's really not a case of law, but he seems to assume it's not even a borderline case of law. Not even a borderline case of law. 50 years after Hart published The Concept of Law, we're still fighting about whether international law is really law, precisely because there isn't any centrally organized entity that would count as an authority with the ability and authority to impose sanctions or coercive enforcement mechanisms for noncompliance. Now, look, this is just a logical matter. Given the methodology that we start from, coercion seems to be a paradigmatic feature of law. Paradigmatic. An example of that is as clear as the fact that law consists of norms, and he rejects the view that coercive enforcement mechanisms are conceptually necessary on the basis of what is best, at best, a borderline case of law. I think that's just too quick when you consider the ubiquity and centrality and the sense that it makes of coercive enforcement mechanisms in law. All right, the next argument, the Society of Angels argument. And Raz endorses the Society of Angels argument, but in order to sort of, there are two ways you can interpret this. The first way, the strongest way, is not Raz's view, but it gestures in the direction of what I think goes wrong with some of the other arguments. The second version of this, Shapiro makes it in legality. He calls it Cook's Island. It's really Raz's Society of Angels argument, just repurposed, repackaged, remarketed, rebranded. Okay, so on this view, and Raz holds this view, even a Society of Angels will require a system of law to solve coordination problems and disputes that might arise in the society. As Raz puts it, is it possible for there to be a legal system in force which does not provide for sanctions or which does not authorize their enforcement by force? The answer seems to be that it is humanly impossible, but logically possible. Now let me stop right there. It doesn't even matter what he means here, you know, how you carve out the specifics of the example. The minute you go humanly impossible but logically impossible, you've misunderstood the concept of law, the very concept of law that we're trying to give an analysis of, because that concept refers to a distinctively human phenomenon in this sense. I mean, it doesn't necessarily, the concept of law can apply to society of beings that are not genetically human. Being human is a genetic property, right? Maybe there are Martians, you know, that are intelligent and so on. No, not Martians, I don't know, Plutonians or whatever, some planet out there where there's intelligent life. Razians. Huh? Razians, yeah. a planet called Razia, where there are Razians who are intelligent, self-interested, and live in a world of material scarcity. Even though the concept of law refers from our perspective is a distinctively human institution, it can apply to non-humans, but it has to apply to beings that have the salient characteristics that human beings do, self-interested, and live in a world that has the salient characteristic that ours has, namely, is subject to material scarcity. So law will function as an effective way of mediating conflicts that might arise among beings likely to solve disputes over conflicts of interest, disputes of interest, by violence. Okay, so right away you can tell, you know, without any further description of the Society of Angels problem, what my response is going to be. Humanly impossible? Well, but logically possible? I'm sorry, the mistake occurs right there on my view given my analysis. And again, whether or not whether or not my analysis works depends for you, depends on whether you buy the underlying argument. And, you know, I can't do any better job of defending the claims I made earlier than the way I did. Okay, so the answer seems to be that it's humanly impossible, but logically impossible, to continue the quote. It is humanly impossible because, for human beings as they are, the support of sanctions is required to assure a reasonable degree of conformity to law and prevent its complete breakdown. Raz is actually agreeing with me on what the purposes of legal systems and states are. It's just that he's going to pull from his own methodology a concept of law that extends beyond beings like us to societies of angels. Continuing the quote, and yet we can imagine other rational beings who may be subject to law, who have and who would acknowledge that they have more than enough reason to obey the law regardless of sanctions. Even a society of angels may have a need for legislative authorization to ensure coordination. That's from Raz, Practical Reason and Norms, pages 158 and 159. Now, there are two ways to understand this argument, and the way that Raz intends it is more or less isomorphic, or the same argument that Shapiro's Cook's Island argument is. But I want to talk about the first stronger way. The first stronger way would be, Raz misspeaks when he talks about a society of angels. You know, as we'll see later, the residents of Cook's Islands are not angels, rigorously speaking. The concept of an angel is such that an angel is characterized by two features. Morally infallible, an angel always knows what the morally right thing to do is. And morally impeccable, in the sense that an angel always does the morally right thing. So angels never resort to violence. Never resort to violence, or theft, or any of these other things. Law for them would just be a matter of solving coordination problems, and there would never arise any dispute under substantive provisions of law because they would always know what's morally right. In fact, that creates another problem for the strong version, which nobody holds, but again, it's useful to consider this because it helps to make the point. In the concept of law, Hart makes some really interesting claims about the problem of legal content, and that's a big problem. The question that the problem of legal content poses is whether there's any necessary content to law. Raz does something interesting in his book, first book, The Concept of a Legal System. He points out that there are four problems that a theory of a legal system has to solve to be successful. One of them is the problem of legal content, and that problem is there any necessary content that every conceptually possible legal system has? And then Raz goes on to say, in what follows, I'm not going to address this issue, but yet purports to give a complete theory of a legal system. That's odd, to put it mildly. One of his reasons for ignoring the problem is that very few theorists have discussed it. He says that Hart is really the only one who's been bothered by it. Well, that's not a good reason for not addressing a problem that you think is essential to solving the problem, conceptual problem of identifying the existence conditions of a legal system. Hart addresses the problem. Hart argues that there are certain, that the law must contain certain content as a conceptual matter a system of norms must contain as a conceptual matter to count as a system of law. And that is what he calls the minimum content of the natural law. And I want to say something about this. It's important not to make too much of what he calls it. It's a sort of a polite gesture to natural law theorists. He's not presupposing a natural law theory of morality, and he's actually, he's not even making any claims about what moral principles have to be in law. This is about what rules a system of norms, an institutional system of norms, has to be efficacious, and efficacy is a necessary condition for a legal system. So these are rules, although they reflect moral rules, and you know, if you're a natural law theorist on morality and on law, these are going to be rules that are part of the natural law theory of morality. He says, but it's not about morality for him, and it's not about natural law, it's about efficacy. He says, quote, "Reflection on some very obvious generalizations, indeed truisms, concerning human nature and the world in which men live, show that as long as these hold good," and here's where you can see, he's not talking about morality. "There are certain rules of conduct which any social organization must contain if it is to be viable." That's exactly the claim I was making about the characteristic need of the state. So Raz and Hart, by my view, although they don't know it. One, because Hart is dead, and two, because Raz probably doesn't read my work. "Such rules do in fact constitute a common element in the law and conventional morality of all societies which have progressed to the point where these are distinguished as different forms of social control." That's a separate claim. He's just claiming, look, these rules that are necessary to make viable social communal living are also reflected in conventional morality, right? We've come to think that they're rules of morality, whether or not they really are. "Such universally recognized principles of conduct which have a basis in elementary truths concerning human beings, their natural environment and aims, may be considered, right? I mean, he's expressing skepticism about natural law and about morality, conventional morality. He's expressing skepticism about this. "May be considered the minimum content of natural law." That's just a polite way of gesturing to John Finnis. "John, I disagree with you, but I see there's an element of truth in some of what you say." The general form of the argument, again, this is exactly what I said earlier, and Raz endorsed his position earlier. The general form of the argument is simply that without such a content, law and morals could not forward the minimum purpose of survival which men have in associating with each other. Without such content, law and morals could not forward the minimum purpose of survival which men have in associating with each other. Okay, now Hart makes sort of the same move that Raz does in thinking about the role of coercion. He talks in terms of these rules are naturally necessary. He talks in terms of natural necessity. And again, what this suggests is, actually, it's inconsistent with his view about international law. And I hadn't noticed this before. If he thinks international law counts as law and there are no sanctions, international law, oh, actually, I'm wrong. Never mind. Strike that. My bad. Forgive me. All right. So, like Raz, Hart regards the authorization of coercive enforcement mechanisms as a natural necessity given the nature and purpose of human beings. This suggests that Hart believes that it is not a conceptual truth that law includes a system of coercive enforcement mechanisms. But again, if we go back and look at Hart's own views about what concept of law we're interested in, the concept of a municipal legal system that defines a modern state, well, that's distinctively human. And instead of claiming it's naturally necessary, I mean, that's Hart's own view, that the concept of that law is a distinctively human institution. If you go back and look at this, his views about the natural content, the minimum content of the natural law, are inconsistent with his own views about what concept of law we're interested in. So if that's the case, the first version of the Society of Angels argument doesn't do any work. Then let me say something very quickly about the second argument, the second version of the Society of Angels argument, Cook's Island. Scott Shapiro, and this is how Raz actually describes the problem. So, you know, Shapiro, as far as I can tell, Shapiro's argument is simply Raz's argument, rebranded, yeah, humanized. Shapiro argues that, I didn't mean for that to sound bad. Yeah, that's he said it. Scott argues that there are other conceivable social contexts in which there could be a system of law without sanctions, and one that seems to avoid the problem with Raz's argument. So Scott asks us to consider a group of subjects who all accept the legitimacy of the system and commit to abide by the rules of a legal system. So on his view, then, that would be a system in which, you know, law would be necessary, but you don't need coercive enforcement mechanisms. Now, I have a couple of objections to this. The first is that Scott's argument for this begs the question. It assumes the very thing he's supposed to be proving. Let me quote his reasoning. Quote, some might object and deny that Cook's Island has a genuine legal system because its plans do not impose penalties in case of disobedience. It seems to be a mistake, however, to consider sanctions to be a necessary feature of law. There is nothing unimaginable about a sanctionless legal system. In fact, we just imagined one. No, not on my view. Right? He's just asserting the very thing that he has to prove and begging the question. So it seems to me that it begs the question. But there's another way to see it. Since conceptual analysis ultimately rests on pre-theoretic intuitions about, among some relevant class of speakers, in the case of law, legal practitioners, officials, as well as ordinary folks, whether or not a conceptual claim is true depends critically on whether or not it can be reconciled with ordinary intuitions and among the relevant class of speakers, which would include legal practitioners who have a certain pre-theoretic understanding of the legal practices that construct our concept of law. So Shapiro might simply be asserting that ordinary intuitions would characterize the system of law of Cook's Island as a system of law. Well, here's the problem. And this also applies to, this is an objection that also applies to my own view. I'm assuming that where I'm starting from conforms to ordinary intuitions. But whether what it means to say that an intuition is ordinary is to say that it's commonly shared among the relevant class of speakers. And that's an empirical question. You actually have to go out into the world and take a poll to see whether an intuition is ordinary in that sense. So to say that an intuition is ordinary is to say that most speakers from the relevant class of speakers share that intuition. Now, so let's go out and look for a moment. Well, first, there are a number of distinguished theorists who would disagree that a sanctionless legal system or a legal system that doesn't authorize coercive enforcement mechanisms doesn't include coercive enforcement mechanisms. Finnis believes that law is coercive in character. Dworkin believes that law is coercive in character. Kelsen believes that law is coercive in character. Tomas believes that law is coercive in character. Emir believes that law is coercive in character, and although I'm not sure of him too, so, you know, it doesn't appear, at least among those speakers, and I don't, that the intuition is ordinary. But here's a little interesting thought experiment that I've performed on a number of occasions in connection with talks about legal obligation as well as talks about coercion. I've talked about this issue to groups of first-year law students, and I've been lucky enough in a way to get them within their first couple of weeks of their first year of law school. You know, they have a pre-theoretic understanding of law. They've had enough, you know, already learned enough about law to have informed intuitions. And what I've done is this, okay, and I'm going to do it in the case of Brazil. Imagine an institutional system of norms that looks exactly like that of Brazil's, every respect except one. No, coercive enforcement mechanisms are not authorized for any violations of law. The question then would be, on your intuition, do you have a system of law? Well, in every place I've ever asked, you know, law students or lawyers, you know, my wife, I frequently go to her because she's been practicing law for 25 years and she has informed intuitions about law. And when I presented the case to her, she's like, why would you even ask me that question? Right? Isn't that obvious? You practice law for a little while, Ken. And I was like, well, thank you for answering the question, and no thanks for answering it in such an arrogant... Yeah. They go together. Yeah, they go together. So my suggestion is that, you know, either Shapiro's argument begs the question, or if it's interpreted as a claim about just a claim that expresses ordinary intuition, it's false. The second and more important problem with the idea that law doesn't, and I'll finish up here, doesn't necessarily include coercive enforcement mechanisms or the authorization of coercive enforcement mechanisms, is without it, there's no answer to the problem of legal normativity. There's no answer to the problem of legal normativity, right? Look, Raz and Hart recognize that sanctions are necessary to keep the peace. Why? Because when you add sanctions to legal norms, you provide a reason for action. And the reason for action is prudential, right? It appeals to your self-interest. Now, if there are no coercive mechanisms, then there's no prudential reason to follow law. And it's generally accepted, nor are there any moral reasons. And moral reasons and prudential reasons seem to exhaust the class of basic reasons, atomic reasons. Most political philosophers, Raz included, believe that there are no prima facie moral reasons for obeying law simply because it is law. And this expresses itself in Raz's view in a very interesting way. Raz claims that law purports to provide exclusionary reasons, right? But exclusionary reasons are generated, on his view, only by morality. So he takes the view that law claims morally legitimate authority, and morally legitimate authority provides exclusionary reasons, so law merely purports to provide exclusionary reasons. Law, on Raz's view, does not provide exclusionary reasons, right? Because law does not necessarily give rise to moral reasons for action. He actually devotes a couple of essays to establishing that claim, and so the claim that law does not, by nature, include authorization of coercive enforcement mechanism entails that law by nature provides no reason for actions, and if that's the case, then we can't explain why we use it, and I'll stop here.
Okay, thank you very much, Ken. I think that the best way for us to take the best of our time is move quickly to some comments by both Thomas and Ima, and then we Ken can answer these questions, and then we can move straight to the audience questions, and we can follow up on debate. But before saying that, I'd like just to correct my lack of kindness with Professor Thomas, who is the real responsible for having this meeting with both Ime and Ken. He is the organizer of this huge seminar conference it's finished now, in Belo Horizonte, and he was kind enough to let us invite and have this opportunity, and so to be like free riders of his effort. So thank you very much, Thomas, and I give you the word.
Well, okay, yeah. I think I should be the one to thank because it's a very, very small gesture if you compare with what Ronaldo has given me. Ronaldo has given me a year, a wonderful year here in São Paulo at USP. And it was a very exciting. It was a year where I learned a lot under his supervision and also with the brilliant students that he provided for me. So I mean, this is beyond comparison, much more important. And I am extremely grateful. And this is perhaps something that we did together. Well, so let me now come back to Ken's paper, which I think it's very plausible. I tend to agree with the main thesis of the paper. But while he was speaking, I was thinking about what can I ask him? What are the specific points where we can establish a dialogue? So I just noted a few points where I might have some doubts, even though they're not strong enough to say that I have an opposite claim, but I'll have some doubts, and it's worth it to debate them. The first is the conception that of coercion that Ken uses in the paper. I argued against Schauer in a review of his book, The Force of Law, that Schauer uses too broad a notion of coercion. He thinks that sometimes Schauer confuses coercions with incentives. He has an argument about some countries where people who go to the army receive a grant to go to the university. And he says, look, this is so good for the poor communities that otherwise will have no access to education that it's almost a coercion. It coerces them into the military service. I think that this is not... this is not a good argument because it mixes up things and it goes against the conceptual framework that Hart uses and that Ken uses too. I think that we should define coercion in a narrower way, and I think that in order to debate, to engage in a conversation with Hart, we should use coercion also in a more strict way, because this is the sense that Hart himself was using. So I would like to hear Ken's view about that. Furthermore, I would like to try to make a distinction of emphasis in Dworkin's claim where he speaks about coercion and the debate between, let's say, Hart, Raz, and Ken. When Dworkin thinks that it is essential to the law that it talks about justified coercion, I think that there is an ingredient that is not absent in these others' accounts. Dworkin wants to emphasize that legal action must be morally justified. So it must be authorized by morality in the sense that we must construct the law in a way that its action, including the actions that affect other claims and interests and coerce people somehow, they are morally justified. And I think that there is a distinct claim here. I think that Ken is talking that the law itself authorizes coercion. So maybe it's not exactly the best comparison to make to talk about working. And I mean, of course, that does not mean that Dworkin would not agree with Ken. I just think that perhaps it's not the I mean, that there's a difference that might that should be emphasized. I think that I would have some things to say about methodology, which where we disagree most. But I assume that Ronaldo will have something to say about that because he's more Dworkinian than me. So I will leave it to him. So he has something to say. Okay. I will speak now about one thing that where I am more sympathetic to Raz, to Hart, not Raz, but to Hart than you. I think that his argument about international law is underrated by your analysis. I think that it is a good argument. It is a good argument because most I think that if we keep Hart's criterion, let's talk about the law as the man on the English bus, the Clapham bus. I don't know if I got it right, but and we all in this room, and most of all states who engage in the practice of international law, they regard international law as binding, as valid, and as law. There's no. I mean, there are a few legal theorists that don't. Eric Posner and his friends in the U.S. they say, okay, international law is rubbish, and states decide on the basis of domestic politics whether or not they want to abide by the international agreements that they make. But I don't think that this is right. I think that when we consider international law, we regard it as binding, we regard it as law, and people make claims about it. And Hart has a very, I think that though very succinct, I mean, it's a very bad chapter, the chapter 10 about international law. Jeremy Waldron has a recent article that is very good, and he says, look, if you follow Hart's own theory, we would have a much better conception of international law. So we can make a Hartian theory of international law, and Waldron tries to do that in the piece called Is International Law a Small and Unimportant Part of Jurisprudence? And I like this, I like this argument. But one of the good arguments, and Waldron spells out for a few more paragraphs than Hart does, but one of the good arguments that Hart makes in that bad chapter is that, look, it is in the nature of the relations on the international sphere that we do not need sanctions as much, because there are some natural deterrents. International aggression is always something that will be public. It's always something that will affect many people. It's always something that will be costly. That will have costs. It's always something that is unpredictable. So there are some natural deterrents. So international law can need not to dispose of many sanctions, because states will always have reason not to violate it. They may add sanctions, but it's much less important than in municipal laws. So I think that perhaps you could just give more thought to Hart's argument, even though it was constructed in a much succinct way. I think it's a much better argument than Ross's argument. That's one of the things that I would like to point as a suggestion to your paper. And also, I would like to say something about the methodology, because but I will not question the methodology itself. I will not question the methodology itself like Ronaldo will. I will question the scope of the thing that you were analyzing when you speak of law. I would like to question whether it is necessary to imagine a single account that would explain all legal systems. I can skip that. But the method. No. Okay. Because to counter, I would say that just Hart's your methodology is the same as Hart, and it is too ambitious. Because if I can think of one single case or one single legal system that does not have coercion defined in the strict sense that Hart says, and not in the broad sense that Schauer and others says. If you think of a strict conception of coercion that excludes incentives from the concept of coercion, and we think only about coercive mechanisms in a more negative or sanctioned way. So it would be sufficient to imagine one single legal system without coercive enforcement in order to counter that. And I don't understand why you need that. You need to adopt a methodology that is as ambitious as that. Neil McCormick has given a few examples of non-state legal systems, according to his view, because they would have rules of recognition and because they would have play the same role that Raz says that the law plays, like coordinate action and doing things like that. For instance, international sports association, religions, non-state associations, and let's imagine now hackers community and people who perform and do things in deep web, where it is impossible to coerce them, because it is impossible, because it is even hard to identify them. So can we think of some form of law emerging in a context like that? So I don't know, I'll leave the question open, but I just wonder whether we need to adopt such an ambitious methodology. And I think I'll stop at that because I want to leave time for others. So I did not challenge the methodology itself like I did in Belo Horizonte, because I have a stronger army sitting beside me of Imer and Ronaldo.
So would you like to respond it?
Okay. Thank you for those excellent comments, Thomas. Your first comment was that the notion of coercion I was presupposing was too broad. I didn't say anything about the content of the notion of coercion, but if you want me to give you an analysis of the concept of coercion, it would be this. X coerces, A coerces B to do something if and only if A threatens some kind of consequence that is sufficient to B for noncompliance that would lead B to comply with A's order when A would otherwise not do so. So it's very narrow. It's threatening some kind of an unpleasant consequences. That's coercion. Now there's some interesting issues with respect to what cases actually satisfy that. There are some borderline cases. Certainly, if you point a gun at me and say, give me your money, you're coercing me. And that's what the law does. You know, when it comes to taxation, law enforces criminal prohibitions by threats of violence. If I break the law and they catch me, they're going to point a gun at me and arrest me. And if I'm black in the United States, they're going to shoot me, whether I'm doing anything bad or not. And they'll handcuff me, take me away by force. That's a paradigm case of coercion. It's the same thing going on in the case of law and in the case of an armed robber, which is why the problem of moral legitimacy of legal systems is so important, right? That the problem, there's no real problem explaining how law, what law does is morally justified if it doesn't include coercive enforcement mechanisms. If law doesn't enforce its norms, then it's telling you what to do, but that's it. There's no threat of coercion. There's no threat of any sort of violence. And the worst that you can say about law, then, morally speaking, is, hey, man, that's a little rude, right? Ask me to do it. Don't tell me to do it. That's certainly rudeness. The rudeness of a legal system certainly isn't a moral theory that's important enough to justify expending hundreds and hundreds of thousands of pages on the problem of moral legitimacy. So in any event, I don't think that, you know, I disagree. I don't think that the notion of coercion that I'm using is too broad. I'm not familiar exactly with how broad Schauer's is, but I'm certainly I'm presupposing a notion of coercion that's fairly narrow. The difficult cases are this, you know. Forgive me. This should not be taken as indicative of anything going on in my relationship with Maria. But Maria could say to me, look, Ken, if you don't wash the dishes, you're not getting sex. Now, is that coercion? I don't know. That's a borderline case. I don't have an answer to that. It doesn't seem like coercion to me. It seems unfair, mean, and we will probably have a fight about this. But I'll wind up doing the dishes anyway. So I don't think that's coercion. But the point I want to make is the notion of coercion that I'm presupposing is narrow. But no matter what kind of concept you're dealing with, you're gonna have to deal with borderline cases. Secondly, forgive me, you're the expert here on Dworkin, but I think you're getting Dworkin wrong. First, to kind of refer to your first objection, I think I'm presupposing exactly the same notion of coercion that Dworkin is. So if you think mine's too broad, you think Dworkin's is too broad, and well, you've got a beef with your own view as well as mine, and I don't think you ever disagree with yourself. So if you don't disagree with yourself on this case and I'm agreeing with you, then you agree with me. It's transitivity, I think. But I don't think that Dworkin argues that legal action must be morally justified in the following sense, that a law is not valid. I mean, this is a really difficult issue in Dworkin. It's hard to determine whether Dworkin is really a third way in between strong natural law theory and positivism. He claims he's not a strong natural law theorist. The strong natural law theorist says that X is legally valid if and only if X conforms to morality. I don't think Dworkin is taking that position. I think he recognizes that, for example, Plessy v. Ferguson in the United States, when it established that public school segregation was legal, I think he regarded that holding as law, and he regarded Brown v. Board of Education's holding that public school segregation is unconstitutional as also law. One of those can't be morally justified. I don't think he's going to take the position that either of them wasn't law. If he does, then he's committed to the strong natural law theorist, and that simply can't be grounded in legal practice. The international law comment. I haven't read a whole lot about this. This is not an issue that I'm particularly interested in. Hart dismisses the idea that law is necessarily coercive on the basis of just that example. Now, look, that's still being contested. That's still being contested. At the very best, it's a borderline case of law because people are still fighting about whether or not it's really law. We heard a paper at your talk that there concerning whether or not there's some kind of global constitution. Well, look, that involves an analysis of the concept of constitution. If there is a global constitution, I found that thesis extremely implausible. It would be at best a borderline case of what a constitution is. May I finish, please? Secondly, to say that international law is not really law is not to say that it's not of interest to jurisprudence and not of interest to law schools and law students, because international law, such as it is, has many characteristics in common with law, with national law, which is part, but lacks some, which is exactly what makes it a borderline case of law. And the things that are done here, there are legislatures, there are courts, there's judicial interpretation. The only people who are really qualified to do all of that stuff get degrees in law. So of course it's going to be a topic of interest in jurisprudence. So the claim, and I don't think international law is really law, unless you can start pointing to a central authority that has the ability and the authorization to impose sanctions. But regardless of whether or not that's right, it's still going to be a topic that's necessary. That's necessary with respect to the study of law. As for your last claim about methodology, why is conceptual analysis concerned with identifying features that are common to all conceptually possible legal systems? Well, that's just because that's what conceptual analysis is. Everywhere in philosophy, that's just presupposed everywhere. Now, there's some people who doubt whether you can give a conceptual analysis of a concept that consists of nothing but necessary and sufficient conditions, and people point to concepts that are defined in terms of family resemblances, where, you know, one game might have four or five properties associated with games, and another game might have four different, you know, four or five, but a different four of the same five. Well, that's true. You know, family, there are family resemblance concepts, but logically, you can express those concepts in the form of necessary and sufficient conditions. It's just that the conditions will be expressed in the form of a logical disjunction. Either the system has this particular set of four or five properties, and so on.
Well, Imar asked me to speak before him. Just had a lot of comments to your very dense article, but I'll try to make just one basic point, even though divided in some sub-items. The first point is that, well, it seems that when I was reading your paper, that sometimes you talk about the obedience to a norm. And in many ways, and when you compare your own position with Dworkin's, he stresses very much the fact that the obedience to law or the loyalty to law, whenever he speaks about this, he's taking the whole system, not only of legal rules that were posited by authority, but also the law as a very complex practice that involves also arguments, legal reasoning, and things like that. And whenever you think about the point of obedience to law, this also, according to him, which I think he's right in saying this, makes the very concept of obligation not only a descriptive sociological concept, but an interpretive concept, to say this in his own words. And the point here is that this kind of practice, I mean, the kind of behavior that that is at stake whenever we talk about the very concept of duty or obedience, has to do with the value that is implied in this very action. And for this reason, I think that's one of the reasons why he talks about this political hypothesis for the law as a whole, and that's the point where I see the moral point of obedience. Obedience is not basically do something as a consequence of some kind of many different complex causal forces, social pressure, but it has to do with having reasons connected to some value that we attach to this very behavior. So, and I think that this is also connected to one of your assumptions, the assumption that the law regulates self, that men are self-interest beings, which I think fits quite well whenever we analyze some very specific settings. However, it's a very contested assumption whenever we think about what is a human being, what are the kinds of purposes that human beings usually follow whenever they interact. I mean, of course, in many times they behave in order to promote some interest. However, in many other situations, and I would say basically in many situations that are very central for the definition of what law is, we have this idea of some value that is a guidance for their behavior. And not only a value that could be considered in a conventional way, according to a conventionalist conception of value. However, but on the contrary, in many ways, we are we're beings, value-oriented, but also oriented to some kind of self-reflective conception of value. And I think that this is what is at stake whenever we think about the reasons we have to obey. And just a final point. In saying this, you make in your text a lot of distinctions about, for example, the very notion of acquiescence, and compare this to this idea of compliance. But I was wondering if, for example, you would consider the very concept of legal obligation, moral obligation, as connected to another, in Dworkin's terms, interpretive concept, which is responsibility. I mean, in a sense that we in many ways feel that or acknowledge an obligation whenever we acknowledge some kind of responsibility. In this sense, we sometimes feel that we have an obligation, to care about our own lives, for example, our responsibility towards our good life. But I was wondering whether this would fit your own conception of obligation. And I'm saying this because this is a kind of ordinary meaning of obligation as well. I mean, the obligation one has to oneself.
Let me begin with your second question first. And thank you for the outstanding and very constructive observations on my argument. I don't have anything to say about moral obligation in the paper. I do some analysis on the conceptual analysis on the notion of obligation. When you're talking about moral obligation and you're talking about legal obligation, and this is a view that's, I think, largely uncontroversial. The notion of obligation that is at work in the term legal obligation or the phrase legal obligation is exactly the same notion that's at work in the phrase moral obligation. Same with rights, legal rights and moral rights. That's a view that is accepted, I think, rather uncontroversial. Raz makes the point, and that's interesting. What will be different, though, is this. You know, the difference between moral obligation and legal obligation, it doesn't have to do with a difference in the concept of obligation. It has to do with a difference in the source of the obligation, one being the rules of morality, the other being the rules of law. And that difference makes a very important difference with respect to the normative force. Moral obligation, if you're trying to explain the normative force of moral obligation, you're going to have to give a radically different account than legal obligation. And that's true even if you are a theist who accepts the divine command theory of law, and that according to which, you know, God commands the law and backs things up with a sanction. According to Christianity and Islam and Judaism, it's not that every norm is enforced by a divine sanction. It's in order to avoid the divine sanction, you have to accept a certain religious view. So even someone who takes a position that moral obligation at some level or religious salvation involves an element of coercion, they're not going to take the position that every norm is obligatory because it's coercive. The story is much more complicated than that. In any case, the other thing I want to say about moral obligation is you mentioned twice that we have a moral obligations to ourselves. That actually seems, and I don't want to debate this because this is peripheral, but that actually seems very odd to me, because moral obligations can be waived by the person to whom they're owed, right? You have a moral obligation not to enter my house without my permission. I can waive that and then let you into the house. But I can also retract my waiver at any given time, and if I retract my waiver, then you're morally obligated to leave my house. So the problem that I have with the idea that one can owe moral obligations to oneself is you can waive moral obligations that are owed you if you owe them to yourself. Well, you can waive them to yourself, but if you can waive moral obligations to yourself at any time, then there's no meaningful sense in which one's bound. So not that that has anything to do with my paper, but I just want to make the... No, I mean, I just wanted to make the observation that I thought the example is somewhat odd. Not everybody will agree with my analysis, so that would be contested, but that's my reaction. As for the notion of obedience, I'm not sure I said a lot about obedience in the paper. And to tell you the truth, obedience plays less of a role in law than people think. I mean, I've never murdered anybody. And the reason it's not, I'm not obeying the law prohibiting murder when I fail to murder, when I decline to murder someone, because I'm not doing it because the law says so. And I'm not doing it because the law backs up its murder laws with the threat of a sanction. I do it for other reasons, moral reasons, reasons having to do with caring about people, altruistic reasons. It's got nothing to do with the law. If the only reason that you're not killing me, for example, is that it's illegal, I think there's something wrong with you, personally. I think you're in need of treatment, because first of all, if there are no sanctions and the only reason you're not murdering me is because the law says so, you have a strange fetish for the law. And if it's all about, you know, not going to jail, well, that's even worse. I mean, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you're dangerous, I need to stay away from you, and quite frankly, you need therapy. You know, most people, there's a difference between conforming your behavior to the law and obeying the law. Obedience involves conformity, but obedience involves conformity for the reason that law has made it, has prohibited it, either, you know, just because law has prohibited it, or it's backed the prohibition up with certain sanctions. And in fact, let me go a little further. If any part of your reason for not killing me is that the law prohibits it, I think to that extent there's something wrong with you. It is no part of why I'm not killing you, none, zero, whatsoever, that the law prohibits it. Or that I break lots of laws, and so do you. If you jaywalk, you've broken the law. So it's not like all of you are committed to doing whatever the law says because the law says so. You know, when I was in... I probably shouldn't say this because Thomas is here. But when I was at the Congress, I mean, the Thomas organized, it was brilliantly organized. I mean, I have never seen a conference on such a large scale that wasn't international. I mean, it was on the scale of something like the IVR that ran so smoothly. I just can't fathom how it is that he did this. But he put his grad students to work and, you know, had them drive us here and there, you know, which was very nice and made life much easier. But one driver, I'm not gonna say who, she's driving and trying to figure out how to get somewhere, and she's texting while she's driving. That's against the law. So all of us, do you? Sorry, Anna, if you're out there and you could hear this. So none of us are fetishists about the law. We all, there's nobody in this room who hasn't broken the law. So none of us, this Cook's Island example of Shapiro's, and that's, I think, the respect in which Raz intends the Society of Angels arguments, none of us are like that. You know, most of the things that the laws that we conform to, we don't even need the law to tell us it's illegal. Right? I mean, I don't need the law to tell me don't kill an innocent person, not to kill an innocent person. I don't do it because I love people and because I'm just not psychologically constructed to kill someone. So I'm not sure that I said, there's one other point. I'm not sure that I said much about obedience, but you made, Ronaldo made another point about obligation. And as I take, if I understand this correctly, he's suggesting that, you know, the notion of obligation that comes out of my view is, and he's right about this, that being obligated is a matter of the laws coercively enforcing the law. It's the coercive enforcement of law that provides the normative force that obligations are supposed to provide. Now, you know, the worry here is that there's some kind of, if I've gotten you correctly, that there's some sort of is-ought fallacy. Because the story that a positivist is going to tell is going to imply that you can derive an ought from an is. So it's going to work something like this. Look, you know, if legal obligation is purely a matter of what some people tell you to do, right? Well, that's a descriptive claim, and how you can't explain, there's no way to get anything normative about it, out of it. I'm not getting obligation simply out of a descriptive fact. I'm assuming a fact about prudential rationality, which is assumed by every system of law and explains why law employs coercive enforcement mechanisms. As a matter of practical rationality, and here's your normative claim, we have prudential reasons, strong prudential reasons to avoid coercive enforcement mechanisms. So there's nothing purely descriptive about the notion of obligation that you rightly sense is going to come out of my views about coercion. It's that, you know, legal obligations are defined in terms of what people do, but the normative force comes from facts, normative facts about practical rationality.
So let me just first congratulate you in two things. So now you are coming out of the closet, and now you are a Dworkinian.
No, not at all.
I am just kidding. So I was going to welcome you to the club of the Dworkinians, but yeah, I still see why
maybe I'm just still in the closet.
You are still in the closet. So you are not ready to come
and
out of the closet.
That's why I don't do the dishes when Maria threatens to withhold sex, because I'm in the closet.
Okay. Yeah, that's.
I think Anna was checking the GPS. That's all I'm going to say.
Okay. I think you're still in the positive side. And I would like to emphasize that within the positive side, I think you're being right. You're right in the way you're presenting the argument, and I think Ras and Shapiro are wrong in that. So I think, as a matter of conceptual analysis, that's what you're doing, and descriptive conceptual analysis, I think you're absolutely right. And I completely agree with you. My comment was very similar to something of what Ronaldo said, that, and I think the shower works well into that. He was aiming to the problem that they were claiming it has to be necessary, and he was just making the point that it has to be at least important. So I think at least important, it is there. I think it's necessary, so I can go back a little step. So I still see you in the positive side, because you are not bringing the discussion into the justification of coercion, which was Dworkin's point. But again, since you are proving that coercion is necessary to law, then the argument for us to say, well, you see, and it also has to be justified, is kind of easy. But so thanks for helping us kicking Ras and Shapiro out of the picture and coming this way, even though you are still in the closet.
Ken, before I give you the last word, just I'd like to check if anyone wants to make a comment. Yeah, okay. So very, very short, please speak on the phone so that because we're recording. Okay, try to be short.
Okay. Good morning. Excuse me, Professor. I really like your article and I really bought your position. But I have one question regarding the legitimacy of the law. Because Hart uses an example in the concept of law where he puts in the debate where the law comes from. And he uses the example of the gang members that in an area, dominated area, a gang member takes control of it and he asks if that's law or not, or what's the difference between obeying the drug lord of your region or the government in paying taxes. And Holmes used this example as well, and I really like the position of the enforcement of the law, but I don't see how I can make a difference using only that argument to see where does the law come from, or is there any difference for me, from my position, to obeying the gang members or the government?
Actually, my question is quite related to his question. It's about the legitimacy of the law. If I'm not mistaken, you actually mention legitimacy in your paper only one or two times, I believe at page 22, and then you don't mention that that later. And now, you draw from Hess' argument that there is no moral reasons to obey the law. That is, there is no legal normativity apart from moral reasons. Well, and this is a preliminary step for you to make your argument that you must take into consideration coercive enforcement mechanisms as a conceptually necessary feature of law, because such mechanisms enable us to talk about legal normativity based on prudential reasons. if I'm not mistaken, that's your main point. Well, here's my question. If you were to take the idea of law's legitimacy seriously, in a normative sense, for example, regarding political morality and representation, democracy, wouldn't this mean also that we have moral reasons to obey the law? What's my point here? Here I'm trying to draw an argument from a sort of Rousseauian insight that law properly understood is constitutive of human freedom because it enables us to do a lot of things. And in this sense, we have also moral reasons to obey the law. And in a certain sense, we also have moral reasons that are not coercion related to law. I'm not sure if I made the point quite clear. I'm trying to be fast in order to allow people to talk. Okay.
So now we have a time for concluding remarks so that we have time to listen to Ima.
In response to the first question, actually, I think, I've written a different paper. I just presented it the other day at the conference Thomas organized, is the concept of obligation moralized. Nothing I say in this paper says anything about, you know, whether crime gangs ultimately amount to legal systems, and you know whether or not the directives of a crime gang give rise to obligations. I think they don't, and I think that's one of the problems with thinking of the notion of obligation and legal systems purely in terms of institutional structure. Because a crime gang can be organized in the same way, to have the same structure as a legal system, and I don't think crime gang directives obligate anybody, victims or the people who actually accept them. And I wrote a paper, is the concept of obligation moralized? It's available on SSRN, if you don't mind plugging my work, which addresses that very, very problem. And I think it's a very important problem that's been neglected. And it's exactly, it's part of the problem that's, I was going to attribute the mistake to somebody, but that's incorrect. So yeah, I addressed the issue, but not in this particular paper. In response to your question, sir, on my view, there's a distinction between legitimacy and legality. The view that law as such doesn't give rise to moral reasons for action remember, there can be legal systems that are legitimate and there can be legal systems that are illegitimate. Nazi Germany had a legal system, but it didn't have a legitimate legal system. So the norms of Nazi Germany did not give rise even to a prima facie moral reason to obey. Right, the mere fact that a norm comes from a particular source by itself can't give rise to even a prima facie moral reason to obey. That's where legitimacy comes into play. Legitimate legal systems give rise to moral reasons to act. And that's why a theory of political legitimacy is so important. Raz, in his analysis of authority, has a theory of legitimacy, the normal justification thesis. Okay, and the normal justification thesis says authority is legitimate if and only if ultimately it does a better job of figuring out what you ought to do according to right reason or practical rationality than you do. That's a morally normative claim. And when Raz says that law claims morally legitimate authority, well, he recognizes that it might not have morally legitimate authority. But when it does, it gives rise to exclusionary reasons, that is to say, moral reasons for action. When it's not, then it doesn't give rise to exclusionary reasons, and hence, on Raz's view, doesn't give rise to moral reasons. And I think that view is right. Now, one common criticism of Ronald Dworkin is, and I'm just going to repeat the criticism, I'm not necessarily going to endorse this, is that Dworkin conflates legality with legitimacy. Those are two different issues. What counts as law and what counts as law that's morally justified. Now still, even in my account of the law, you know, as such, you know, forgetting about the legitimacy issue, there's a sense in which law, there's a sense in which law gives rise to, I think I've lost the train of my thought here. Oh no. You know what, I think I've, can you real quickly refresh? Oh, now I remember. That's right, I'm sorry. The notion of justification plays a role because the violation of the law provides the legal justification for, you know, for invoking coercive enforcement mechanisms. But law as such, it doesn't necessarily provide a moral justification. When a system of law is morally legitimate, then it provides a moral justification for applying coercive enforcement mechanisms. And see, here's why people think that law, that Dworkin confuses law and legality, because he thinks I'm not even sure this is right, because it comes very close to saying what Raz claims when Raz takes the position that law claims morally legitimate authority. Dworkin thinks it's the conceptual point of law to morally justify the application of coercive enforcement mechanisms. I don't necessarily think he would take the position that every law morally justifies the application of coercive enforcement mechanisms, because if he takes that position, then he puts himself in the strong natural law camp, and he claims to be a middle way between strong natural law and legal positivism. But that was both questions were very nice, as were all three comments. Thank you.